Thanks for the presentation. Yes, I never finished the marathon at the pace of Mario. He also invited me to swimming, but I said no way. No. I mean, we had the discussion when he was tired and I was okay. I remember when those ideas that I will talk about today were conceived. I was in Los Angeles at the time, and I was in the same. I was close to Mario there. And we talked many times, and I believe that it would have been very much interesting in seeing how this evolved out, because we tried to collaborate many times on those things, but then there were several other things to do, but it's too bad it's not here anyway. So what I'm talking about today is a pretty interesting move in my opinion, worldwide research. That is, we are thinking about the cloud as a problem solving of everything. I'm trying to convince you that this is not the case, and we may have in the long term several problems, and we may need to think again to some basically fundamental issues and rethink the cloud structure itself. And just to summarize the story, once upon a time, and I will cast, of course, all this in networking, but I think it's a bigger picture here. So once upon a time, we were used to buy iron equipment for networking. And we had excellent performance, of course. So we were buying, for instance, a load balance and a probe or something. But we had cost issues and flexibility issues. That is, we were buying the device and we couldn't modify it later on. Then in the last decade, everything went to software. So we were very happy to move everything into software. We bought large scale computing commodity hardware and then virtualization techniques. And we basically translated our functions into software by gaining a lot in terms of course, cost and flexibility. Now everything can be changed on the flight. The cost, of course, is the cost of scale. So we don't need to buy independent equipments, but we have a problem. And the problem is performance and power consumption. And then you will say, okay, can we solve about that? Well, I will talk about this later on. But my goal, my presentation is to show you that probably the direction to solve this is to go back to the hardware. Actually, 50 years later or 25 years later, we are going to get back to the original things. That is, come out. Can we come out with some hardware-specific, general-purpose machinery that can support networking? And that's basically the idea. Instead of using general commodity cloud, let's build some domain-specific architecture that are tailored to networking. And those architectures, let's basically implement our networking devices on top of those architectures. We retain programmability, but whose hardware has been specified, made specific for the networking task. And in this case, of course, we can gain in cost and in flexibility because we still retain programmability, but we gain in power consumption and performance because now the iron is done by ourselves and is done so as to fit the specific type of processing that we need in networking. And so basically, in a summary, my talk is the old times are back again. That is, everything was old today. That is, nobody was caring anymore about hardware. I believe now it's back again very strongly into play. And I think that Mario would have liked to see this because he lived all the period in which this evolution came out. So this said, let's move to some background. In this background, I'm stealing some slides from giants in the field, actually Turing Awards, so they are not my slides, but I stole some slides from someone else. But anyway, the idea is the following. There is a huge debate about the Moore law. Everybody knows about the Moore law, and we say the transistor over the chip should double every 1.5 years, and there is a debate ongoing whether the Moore law is dead or not. I see that sometimes for the Intel, for instance, this is Intel processor scaling, and you see that for Intel it's not anymore valid. For other computers, other processors seems to be valid. I'm not entering into the debate, but for instance, when you look at Moore's law in different contexts, you can see that probably we may incur into a scaling problem. For instance, this chart was related to DRAMs, and you see that in the last years, now we double the capacity only after 7 years. So this is a pretty strong reduction into increase, exponential increase speed. But then there is another law that we probably know, everybody knows probably in this room, we are in engineering, it's so-called the Denner's law. It's a 74 paper of Denner that said, that irrespective of whether you make transition smaller and smaller, the power per area should remain constant. Actually, this law has been disattended in the last decade, meaning that this chart shows you that based on the year, that's the density in terms of technology, so the nanometer technology, and that's the power per area consumption. And as you see, after 2006, 2007, we start having an increase in the power consumption, meaning that now probably the power consumption is the bottleneck. We need that sometimes to downscale the clock speed in order just to avoid that it burns, basically. And that's a big issue in a law that is not anymore considered. Okay, but now software people, they say, okay, well, what's the problem? That's a single chip story. Let's go multi-core. Let's go multi-core and we solve all the problem. But there is another law here. It's called the Amdahl's law that says that the speed up of multi-cores is bounded by the level of parallelizability. Sorry for the terminology that I don't think it's English, but I invented it. So the level of parallelization that you can do it for your application. Of course, if you can parallelize 100% of your application, then multi-core scales up. But the point is, what happens when you cannot parallelize it completely? For instance, that law says, basically, there is a small formula that I plotted here. Suppose that you can only parallelize 99%. Now, 99%, it says that if you apply this formula, asymptotically, what you gain is, at best, a 100% improvement in speed up, irrespective of the number of cores you place. And for instance, I made an example here just to show. 1% serialization. So your application is 99% parallelizable, but 1%, unfortunately, is sequential. In that case, basically, with the 128 cores, you have only 56 pair speed up. So you are wasting half of the capacity, meaning that probably multi-core is a very good choice for completely parallelizable application, but it's probably not the solution to our problems. Now, putting all things together, I stole this slide from John Hennessy and David Patterson Turing Awards in 2017. If you look at that, that's basically the way in which scaling is happening up. And you see that at the beginning of the times, we had an increase in performance that was really, really powerful. And now we are in this area in which they predicted that a 2-pair increase in the power of general purpose performance, computing performance, may happen into 20 years, so only 3% every year. That's a scaring result, in my opinion, that calls to a revisitation of what we mentioned about cloud. We believed so far everything could be solved by the cloud. Let's horizontally scale the cloud. But it seems that we have a systematic problem that maybe we don't have it now, but in the future we may have it. So how can we do about that? Well, first of all, can we gain something by moving to specialized computing? I'm not saying anything new, but here we can gain a lot. I just make a couple of examples. For instance, everybody knows about blockchain mining. It's probably a silly example, so I'm not going to convince you that this is good or bad, but just as an idea, what do you need in order to do Bitcoin mining? You need to compute hash function, which is an operation that is pretty slow on a PC. My PC, for instance, my i7 core can run only 66 million hash per second, meaning that if I want to target 1 giga hash per second rate, I need to collect 15 cores that do this kind of work, and I need to spend about 3,000 watts. Now, buy this device. This is a device that costs less than $500. It's an ASIC, of course, but it's a programmable ASIC because there is not only one type of hash function, so there are many of those. And this device actually comes out to run 14.5 tera hash per second, meaning 10 to the 12, consuming about 10 times more than a core, but running actually at 1 million more of the speed almost. So 1400 watts. Meaning that by running this device, you can actually save a factor of 43 dBs in power, meaning that 30,000. The other example that I took, I stole it from John Hennessy. And it's another nice small toy example because it shows you that, for instance, try to do a matrix multiplication in Python. In Python, use this as a reference, 1. Now, implement it in C, low-level language, and we know how to do it. Now, everything goes much faster. A factor of 47 is a huge factor for a compiler, so we're doing actually a serious improvement. But then let's try to implement in C with some parallelization internally, and the factor goes up to 366. Then try also to do manually the memory optimization. Instead of doing caching, leaving the caching of the system, do the caching yourself. So do a more intelligent management of the system.
And you run now at 6 times more than that. And whenever you start using the hardware, accelerated hardware, so you use an Intel instruction for vector multiplication, you go back to 63,000 with respect to the original speed. And that shows you, basically, that you have an improvement over more than 1,400 factor over the baseline software implementation, and even an improvement of 10 times over the most effective software implementation that you can get. So those numbers convinced me, and many other, I guess, that it's worth to come back to the hardware. And it's worth to come back to the so-called domain-specific specialized computing, which is not ASIC. ASIC is actually something that is, I do one application in one chip, that's it. Meaning that if I need to change the application, I need to change actually the ASIC chip. General purpose, so cloud CPU, general purpose CPU, means I have one CPU and I do everything I want on top of that. Now, the idea is, well, let's try to find a compromise. So let's try to find some architecture, computing architecture, which has some specific hardware details. So it's not anymore a normal CPU. It's a tailored architecture with an architecture and instruction set tailored, but not to a specific application, but to a specific domain, meaning, for instance, the networking domain, the machine learning domain, or, for instance, the signal processing domain, and so on and so forth. Now, of course, this is not new, because we know already many classical examples of domain-specific specialized computing. Strange enough, we didn't put it in the cloud, although in some wireless clouds there are, of course, digital signal processor. If you want to process signals or wireless communication, you definitely don't want to go over a normal x86 architecture. You want to go over a specialized digital signal processor that basically is tailored to do that kind of job. And FFT will be done in one clock with respect to, for instance, the many clock that you need to compute it in another part. Or graphical processing unit, for instance, we discussed it before. In graphical processing unit, you can do a lot of good things by image processing, graphics, virtual reality, by having a dedicated hardware that does that kind of job. Be careful, this doesn't mean that there is a graphical processing unit specific for virtual reality, but we can program a virtual reality application on top of that. Now, those are the classical examples, but we have some more recent example. 2017, Google came out with the so-called Tensor Processing Unit. In that case, they developed an hardware tailored to do the neural network inference for machine learning. And it came out that the performance in terms of power consumption with respect to the traditional CPUs was about a factor of 85. So if you use one of these hardware devices, you gain a factor of 85 with respect to a normal CPU, and you even gain a factor of 30 with respect to a GPU, meaning that with this hardware, you can go much faster and with lower power consumption with respect to general purpose. Now, we are not in this field, but we are rather in the other field. And since the last 4 years, we worked in coming out with programmable networking data plane. That is, can we do some general purpose hardware that is specialized to do hardware, to do networking processing in both the switches as well as in the network interface cards? So accelerating functions like TCP or like, for instance, other routing functions in our network interface cards. And we did some work, and basically we found out that there is plenty of room to accelerate with respect to software. Now, this slide is not mine, it's from Nick McCune. Some years ago, he showed that basically the gap between software and hardware is still significant, despite, of course, many of us wanted to move to the cloud. 50 per is a significant gain. And the fact is that basically the specialized hardware for networking, if we compare it to run a networking application over a commodity software, comes out with 4 big assets that are very clear. The first one is, of course, input and output speed up. That is, in a switch, you know that we can run 64 ports at basically no extra cost, whereas try to build a software switch with 64 ports, that's pretty consuming. The second, so this was obvious, basically. Less obvious probably is protocol parsing. If you need to find out for a packet which protocol the packet belongs, you need to run some parsing of the header, so process the header, and it comes out that this can be done very efficiently using some hardware acceleration of some graph analysis or state machine analysis. I will discuss briefly later on this. Then what's the core of a router? The core of a router is take a packet and decide where to go, or where, which kind of decision to take. And typically this implies the lookup of some sort of table. And now it comes out that if you do a match action operation, that is, you take a packet, you see where it has to go, and you look it using hardware acceleration lookup, then you can go down to order of one lookup times with TCAMs or Kukuashis well implemented. And then the other thing is the packet processing via specialized processor. Now, what happens when you want to change a packet? Do you really need full arithmetic precision? Do you really need 64-bit words? No, probably you need less fixed-point precision arithmetics, but you need, for instance, very long instruction words that you can parallelize. And you need, for instance, very often you need to shift many bytes. So unaligned memory, for instance, is a technique that permits you to shift many bytes at one clock instead of moving bytes along and spend so many steps. So all those things actually come out to be pretty interesting in order to emerge with some hardware and programming abstraction for network computing, so computing over packets. Here I'm using the word net putting to mean we want to process packets, but we want also to change the content of the packet, for instance, include it in the tunnel, encrypt it, or do some other operation. Now, which is the best abstraction? There is plenty of people internally in this field. There are some fights on whether the language named P4 is better than other languages and so on. I believe personally that there is not one size fits all language. That is, there are different protocols that can be addressed by different techniques. For instance, if you need to do protocol parsing, now by far the best approach is to describe the way in which you want to parse a packet through a graph, which is basically a deterministic state machine, and then implement it, and in hardware you can implement it in a very efficient manner. But then when it comes to decide where the packet has to go, now the idea is that probably the best abstraction is the if-then abstraction, meaning that I match some content of the packet. If the packet IP address is this, then do that. So the if-then abstraction seems to be the best one in order to take routing decision. It would map immediately over the table inside the routers without basically almost any effort. And there was a protocol named OpenFlow that did exactly this in the past. And then what happens if you want to process packet, meaning change packet? Now, process packet means insert a tag, encapsulate, modify the header, count things. Now, the idea is that you should probably emerge with some specifically tailored arithmetic and logic unit, meaning that you don't take a normal MIPS architecture, but you modify it and you adapt to your own needs. It comes out, we did it, and the cost of this modification is almost marginal, meaning that we can come out with an intellectual property that is basically different from the original MIPS, but the size used is basically the same. So it doesn't cost more than that, actually less than that, because we stripped away many instructions that we didn't need, and we reduced the precision of the arithmetics. So I still have 4 minutes. Just one thing to mention some work that we did to generalize a little bit those abstractions. The match action abstraction is very interesting because you can make it stateful. That is, if you need to take routing decision, you can actually take either routing decision that apply to each packet in the same manner irrespective of the time, but you can actually describe a time evolving behavior, meaning that what you can do is, let's start from a classical flow table. In a classical flow table, you have an if part and a then part. In the if part, you detect something in the packet, and in the then part, you do something with the packet. For instance, if the packet is a TCP SYN, then forward this packet to A, and then maybe set a timer in order to wait until something next happens, okay? So if then is classical programming for forwarding functions. But then, on another line, we recognize that we are used in Computer Science 101 to look at other data, other structures that are definite state machines. Definite state machines, the classical ones, do not have any action part, but they still have an if-then part, meaning that if the state is something and something happens, then let's move to a next state. And this is a standard thing that we learned in our first year class here. But if we can we put everything together, it came out that we developed, at the time in which I was with Mario actually, so we talked about that, we developed a protocol called OpenState that was basically see that we could actually run inside a commodity hardware a more general match action rule that was basically a Mealy machine. And the idea is, if something happens and you memorize the state in which you are, now you can basically trigger an action plus move in the next state. Definition of what is a Mealy machine in computer 101. But then we started working a little bit more. Can we come up with a general purpose machine that is more complete than that? This is non-Turing complete. And it comes out that if you move to extended finite state machines, so you basically add conditions, you add registers, and you add update functions, what you can get is actually a Turing complete processing machine that actually does not use any CPU but can work at line speed. That's what we mean for a domain-specific architecture. We have now have a processor that runs without a standard CPU, but is tailored to do this kind of operation. So now, what is nice of this description, and this is of course a little bit more personal, so I'm defending a little bit our choice here. What I like of this description is that basically you have three things in one, because on one side you have the if-then part can describe what is the behavior of the processing that you want to do. For instance, in time, how you want to change your forwarding decision, and this description does not require you to enter into the specific technical actions that you want to do over the packet. Those can be instruction of a computer. So you don't need to design them. You can just use them. You assemble them by setting up the logical part. So how a state moves to another state and so on and so forth. And this is one plane of programming. Then there is the other plane of programming. You are now the vendor, or you now really want to develop something. Now you use a different model. You enter into the details of what are actually the actions that you want to sustain, and you directly implement them in hardware. Remember, then those will be combined together in a manner described by an upper layer abstraction. So you can come out with a very specialized instruction that does, for instance, CRC checking, and it takes only one clock cycle, and then you can basically use it by the behavioral description. And finally, in order to run the internal programming logic, you have a third part of the abstraction. In an extended finite state machine, you can define your own variable, your own memory, and your own primitives. And basically what you can do is that you can actually run a microprogram that is basically based on arithmetic and logic unit processor that does this kind of operation. So you define what are the operation, and again, you can actually define registers, operation, and so on. And this is what, for instance, we did. This was the hardware that we implemented it. Just to, I don't have time to discuss because I finished my time. So just the hardware that we did came out, of course, with a significant saving, despite the implementation was on a costly. So we implemented it, of course, in hardware to test that this is feasible, and actually comes out that, as I mentioned, you can save, you can gain performance and save energy, and that was basically the comparison with the best software implementation. We moved from 22 watt to about 120 watt that was consumed by the software part. And then we came out with some processors that are specific to do packet operation. I don't have the time to discuss, but anyway, here what you do is that you focus on parallelism, basically. Because in a packet process, you need to move data. You don't need to compute data. You don't need much multiplication or divisions and so on. You need to move data to enter to shift the data. And then we specialize that with a very long instruction word architecture, actually coming back after a long time, with efficient management of memory and with some specialized instructions. So we stripped away some instruction from a MIPS, we reduced the precision of the arithmetics, and we defined some special joint operation that we needed that could be run in a very small number of clock cycles. Now, why the title of my talk? Because now I believe, and this is my last slide, that this actually will take us to revisit the concept of cloud. From a cloud system where we had only one type of computing architecture, we will have still a cloud system where we merge racks of different computing architecture, but they will start to be specialized. And we will have both in the central cloud as well as in the edge cloud. And the idea is that, for instance, in the future cloud, you will have some hardware slice of computing, meaning that you don't have only logical slice between service, but you also want to have a specialized computing that will save you a lot of energy for programmable artificial intelligence. Hardware racks that will do programmable networking on which you develop a networking function, hardware racks for visual reality and visual processing, and hardware racks for whatever will become important. And the idea, in my opinion, is that in the future, we will have an interesting fusion between software guys and hardware guys that probably with the cloud we separated too much. Thanks a lot. Sorry for the extra delay.